بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين المصطفى أبي القاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله صلى الله عليك يا ابن رسول الله يا شهيد كربلاء رزقنا الله في الدنيا زيارتكم وشفاعتكم في الدنيا والآخرة أما بعد فقد قال سيدنا ومولانا الإمام جعفر بن محمد الصادق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه إنا لنحب من شيعتنا من كان عاقلا فهما فقيها حليما مداريا صبورا صدوقا وفيا صدق مولانا الإمام الصادق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الإمام الصادق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه Today the 25th day of Shawwal in the year 148 coincides with his martyrdom Salamullahi alayh, at the age of approximately 65 years old, give or take. The Imam Salamullahi alayh is well known because he witnessed the downfall of the Umayyad dynasty and the rise of the Abbasid dynasty. This political unrest provided him with the opportunity to publicly teach about Islam, but the Islam of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. The Islam that Allah brought down to humanity, not the Islam of Bani Umayyah. He started to produce individuals who were very well versed and very knowledgeable in religion. As I mentioned earlier today in Salatul Jumu'ah, during his time, Muslims' ideologies started to go right, left, and center. The works of Plato and Aristotle started to be translated. So Muslims started to get familiar with some of these works. And they started to be influenced by them, adopting some of these theories and ideologies. In addition to this, people, because they left Amir al-Mu'mineen Salamullahi alayh, the teachings of Rasulullah Sallallahu alayhi wa alayh, and they followed that man who, when the Prophet was on his deathbed asking for a pen or a paper or the equivalent of pen and paper, he said, Hasbuna kitabullah. We have the book of Allah and it's enough for us. They followed that. The problem is they do not understand Kitabullah. They don't understand it. So each one of them started to interpret it his own way. which created chaos. By the time of Al-Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, this chaos started to penetrate in the Muslim world. A major school started to materialize, known as the Mu'tazilites. Mu'tazilites said that we have a complete free will. The human being chooses whatever he wants. Opposite, another school of thought came, the Asha'irites, who said, no, we have absolutely no free will. It's all predestined. That latter school of thought was prospered, funded by the Umayyads. Why? It makes perfect sense. Why did you become the Khalifa? Allah chose me the Khalifa. No. Why? Do you have something to protest against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why do you steal people's money? Allah. Like Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan used to say, Al-malu malullah. The money is Allah's money. Wa ana khalifatullah. But I am representing Allah. So if I wish to give, I give. And if I wish to deprive, I deprive. You know, I represent Allah. Khalas. End of story. That kind of ideology propagated. And that kind of ideology spread. Although the school became known as the Asha'irites in relationship to Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, who came a bit later, but the roots of that teachings was there. You find Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man having such teachings, have such roots. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam came to clarify, it is not complete free will, nor it is complete predestiny. It is somewhere in the middle. You have the choice to eat the food, whether it is halal or haram. That's your choice. No one is forcing you. You choose to eat halal. You want to pay your khums and make your food halal. That's your choice. No one forces you. Okay. You want to eat halal meat. That's your choice. No one forces you. Once you put that bite in your mouth and you chew it, that's all you, voluntary so far. Once you push it inside, can you control what happens next? Khalas. Then it's a system that you have no control over. So free will and predestiny somewhere in the middle. Okay. With regards to legislation, ahkam, sharia, Allah does not force anyone to do anything. That's your choice. But when it comes to the system of creation, the creation, like what happens inside after you swallow the bite, that food, that's all creation, system, that you have no control over. Don't have control over that. Okay. So you see, somewhere in the middle, Imam al-Sadiq came to clarify. He raised a group of individuals, scholars, to carry this kind of knowledge. A man from Sham comes to Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He comes to him and he says, I heard you have answers to all kinds of sciences. He says, so what would you like? He says, I want to challenge you. Discuss. About what? Quran. Imam says, okay, have a seat. He turns to one of his companions or students, Humran ibn A'yun. He says, Humran, go ahead, challenge him. The man from Sham says, I don't want to challenge Humran, I want to challenge you. He says, challenge him. If you can defeat him, it's as if you've defeated me. Go ahead. He argues with Humran, he loses the argument. Humran wins. He comes back to Imam al-Sadiq. I want to challenge you again. About what? This time about Arabic language. No problem. Abban ibn Taghlub, get up. It's your turn. Challenge him. The man loses the argument. Comes back again. I want to challenge you about something and so on and so forth. Up to six things. Every time the Imam calls one of his students and the man loses. until the man turns to Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, this Shami. He says, it is as if you are trying to tell me that such people are your Shia. He says, yes indeed, those are my Shia. The ilm they have, the knowledge they have. It is such people that carried the knowledge to us today. The knowledge that sometimes we take for granted. Such people. Who today I mentioned one of them, Muhammad ibn Abi Umayr. Ibn Abi Umayr spent 17 years in the prison of Harun. 17 years. Being tortured, being beaten. His wealth was taken away from him. He was a wealthy man, businessman of fabrics. He comes back after 17 years living in the dungeon, in darkness, blind. All his wealth is gone. All his books were destroyed. But does he stop? No, he's still now. He says, whatever I remember from my masters, As-Sadiq wal-Kadhim alayhim as-salam, I will tell you. And people start to write his ahadith. Such people, that's how the knowledge was carried to us. Through such people. Such were the Shia. But in addition to this kind of knowledge, Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, in this hadith that we recited, gives 8 characteristics of what I have put together in the acronym, the wise Shia. Wise contains 4 letters, Shia 4 letters, which consist of these 8 attributes. In addition to the Imam, salamullahi alayhi, teaching fiqh to his companions, making sure they understand religion so well, he wants them to go beyond that. He wants them to be humans. He wants them to be the best they are. He says in one hadith, if you are a Shia of mine and you live in a city where there are 1,000 people in that city, if there is one of them who is more pious than you, then you are not my Shia. That means the Shia should be perfect, or at least tries to be perfect, tries to the best of his ability. What are some of these attributes? Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam in the hadith I just recited earlier at the beginning says, inna, we, referring to who? Who's we? Who's we? Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Imam al-Sadiq, we. La nuhibbu la adatu ta'kidin. Means surely we love of our Shia the one who has these 8 characteristics, not one of them, not 2, all 8. What are they? Wise Shia. W. A Shia should be aqil, means having wisdom. Wise. That's the W. Wise. We'll go to the next one because they kind of combine together. The I. For intelligent understanding. A Shia, not only is he aqil, he has a mind, he's wise, he can read between the lines, he is visionary, he can assess situations and realize what their consequences will be. This is a true Shia. During the time of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, a revolution was happening by people who claimed to love Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. The initial slogan was Ar-Ridha li Ali Muhammad. Sallu ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. We want the pleasure. We're rising seeking the pleasure of Ahlul Bayt. This was the slogan. People gathered together. They came to Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam more than once. Abu Salam al-Khalal came to Imam al-Sadiq, one of the commanders of the army. Abu Musa al-Khurasani came to Imam al-Sadiq, another commander of the army. More than once, they would come to the Imam, telling him, you become the Khalifa. This revolution is for you. Imam salamullah alayhi reads between the lines. He could see exactly what's going on, the whole situation. Who's rising, why they're rising. You know how sometimes on television they would have an interview with a political analyst? Some political analyst. What does he do, this political analyst? He tries to assess a situation. He says, you know, looking at what is happening here, what this person said there, what action was done here, I conclude this. And sometimes some of them who have some understanding, they hit it dead on. How do they know? What does he know? He studies situations. He can read between the lines. Okay. Well, this person who is a political analyst is not better than Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. Imam al-Sadiq tries to teach us, don't be fooled. They came to him, Abu Musa al-Khurasani came to the Imam, said, you become the Khalifa. He turns to him and he says, go sit in the tannur, in the oven that is cooking. Go sit there. He doesn't. A man of the companions comes. He says, go sit. He goes and sits in the tannur. After some time, he says, get up. He gets up. Imam tells Abu Musa, out of these 100,000 men that you claim to be ready for me and obeying me, how many are like this man? Who when I command them to go sit in the burning fire, they would go without even asking me questions. This is submission to Ahlul Bayt. Taslim. Taslim. Because it is submission to Allah. Allah ordered us to submit to Ahlul Bayt. Ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasul wa uli al-amri minkum. Obey Allah, obey the Messenger and those who have a right command over you. Who are they? Ahlul Bayt. Obey them. Ati'u Allah. Allah has combined His obedience with the obedience of the Messenger and with the obedience of Ahlul Bayt. They tell you, go sit in the fire, you go sit in the fire without even asking why. We don't need to know why. Khalas. The Ma'soom said. And that's why a lot of people sometimes say, why do we do this? Why do we do that? How come? I don't understand. Well, sometimes they explain to us why we do certain actions. Sometimes they did not. But we submit. Khalas. Whatever they tell us, we say yes. He told him, how many of those are like this man? He said, not even a single one. He said, then how do you want me to lead this revolution? How will they obey me? Imam realized those people are rising for power. Suppose he becomes the Khalifa. He needs governors. Will these governors obey him? Of course not. Each one will put in his pockets because that's what they're coming for. And how many times today in the world we see this? People who do not realize, do not understand the big picture. A revolution has happened in some country and people say, yes, yes, we need to get rid of that leader of that country. They get rid of him. And indeed, I want to clarify, we do not support any dictatorship. We're not supporting it. But don't just jump on the bandwagon. Figure out what's going to happen after this person is gone. What is your plan? You need to have a strategy. For a successful movement to succeed, you need to have clear goals, clear visions. You need to have the right leadership. You need to have a proper plan how to execute and achieve these goals. You need to have the supporters. Do you have all this in place? If not, what's going to happen? What did we see happen in the Occupy Wall Street movement a few years ago? What happened there? I remember reading in the newspaper a few years ago when that was happening in Toronto. As you know, it happened in several cities. Some news agencies would go and meet with some of these youths who are camping. They say, what are your objectives? We want fairness. How? We don't know. Well, what do you mean you want fairness and you don't know how? This is complete lack of understanding. This is against wisdom and intelligent understanding. You need to have a clear vision. And that's why the movement failed. Movement failed. You don't have the proper leadership. You don't have a clear vision, clear goals. You don't have proper plans. It's doomed to fail. And that's what happened. And that's what you see happening in some countries, what they call the Arab Spring. After the spring came the fall. You know? That tells you there is not much understanding. People need to have a clear vision. In everything you do, everything you do, one should look at the big picture. Even as a community, as a community. If we look at the big picture, for example, let us build a sports complex. Our youth will benefit from it. Let's have some classrooms on it. Let's use these classrooms. Maybe one day we can have another school, Shia school, down the road. Let us be visionaries. Now, some people will say, do we really need it? The answer is yes. Here in Canada, in one city that most of you are familiar with, over 20 years ago, a group of people said, we need to buy a piece of land. It's up for sale. It's really good. Many people objected. Why do we need it? It's so expensive. We have our own place. It's large enough. It fits us. And. Those people had the vision. They said, no, you know what? It's a good deal. We're going to buy it. They bought it. People continued to criticize them. People continued to go against them, slander them, attack them. Until guess what? 20 years later, they built a beautiful center and they moved to that place and they're expanding and expanding. People need to have the vision down the road. Don't just look at today. Look at 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now. Those people, when they bought that land, they thought about 20 years down the road. And this has happened in more than one place. More than one place. People have the visions. We need this here. How come? We've reached the stage now. Now, some people say, well, you're leaving, so what's the point? It doesn't have to do with me. This is something that will benefit the whole community. This does not deal with one individual. We need to be visionaries. Let's start planning. Not just meeting. Meeting is good. But then you start to execute. In Vancouver, may Allah bless him, the one who worked hard on building the center there back in the 70s. Some of you may know him. He died, rahmatullahi alayh. I was told he would tell the people, the builders, those who were building, build. They come to him later, they say, no more money. He said, don't stop, I'll get you the money. Just continue building. Build, don't stop. And indeed, he would go door to door, city to city, raising funds until, mashallah, it was built. Sometimes you cannot, with issues of Imam al-Hussein, salamullahi alayhi, just build. Tawakkal ala Allah. Have some idea, but then tawakkal ala Allah. You need to have that. We need to have that kind of understanding. So W for wisdom. The I for intelligent understanding. You understand what is going on. When a person comes to you with an opportunity, like the man came to Imam al-Sadiq, although it seemed great, you become the Khalifa. Oh, wonderful. No. What's going to happen afterwards? Look beyond. Don't just be happy and jump on the bandwagon. See, are those people sincere? Are they genuine? Is it going to be successful or not? That's what a mu'min, a Shia, would do. Okay, that's the W and that's the I. Wise, then comes the S. And what is the S? It is for scholars. Scholars of religion. We hear just now about how Imam al-Sadiq salamullah alayhi trained some of his companions to become scholars. Even though some of them were businessmen, like Ibn Abi Umayr, he was an alim, but also a businessman. He used to sell fabrics. Jabir ibn Hayyan, he was a chemist. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam taught him. In addition to being a chemist, he was also an alim, a faqih. He knew religion, although he's famous for his chemistry, but he was also an alim of religion. And interestingly about Jabir, recently I was reading about him, and some scientists, contemporary ones, they say that Jabir ibn Hayyan could be attributed to be the father of chemistry, modern chemistry. Jabir ibn Hayyan is the father of modern day chemistry, some Western scientists are saying. Who taught Jabir ibn Hayyan? Who taught him? Imam al-Sadiq. So that makes who is the father, the true father of modern day chemistry? Imam al-Sadiq salamullahi alayhi is the true father of modern day chemistry. And that is something very important. We Shia should be proud. Such are our imams. The fathers of modern day technology come from our imams, salamullahi alayhim, ajma'in. So let us not go after so-and-so. Let us go to the source, the essence. Scholars. Shaykh al-Amini, Ridwanullah ta'ala alayhi, he wrote a book, 11 volumes, called Al-Ghadir. The title of the book is Al-Ghadir. Rahmatullahi alayhi. He died from the last century, not too long ago. Sheikh Al-Amini, because of his, at that time there was no internet and Google, you know, all the good old search, everything is online. When he wanted to have sources, books, he would actually travel. So he would travel to Egypt to go to some libraries because there are some books he wants to read. He would travel to India. He went to India because there are some sources, resources over there. Iraq, Iran, etc. So he traveled just to go look for resources to do his research and to put his book. One day he came across a man. He started to have a conversation. He finds him, mashallah, quite knowledgeable. He tells him, what do you do? Are you alim? He says, no, I'm not an alim. He says, what do you do? He says, I'm a businessman. I have a shop. I'm a shopkeeper. He says, mashallah, you know quite well for a shopkeeper. But this back in those days. He says, well, every day, I make a commitment to myself. I challenge myself that within, let's say, 5 days or 1 week, I have to read this book. I go buy a book and I tell myself, I must finish it. If I don't finish this book, I will penalize myself. I'll pay a penalty of a big money. Let's say, for example, $100. And back in those days, $100 was a lot of money. He says, so I didn't want to pay the $100. So I would force myself to read the book. So every 5 days, 7 days, I finish a book. Then I go pick up or buy another book, and so on and so forth. So I've read a lot of these books. He's an ordinary man like you and I. Today, our youth, how much time do they waste on social networking websites? How much time do they waste on gaming? At least, pick up a book like Kitabul Irshad by Sheikh Al-Mufid, which is the history of our imams, alayhim as-salam. Pick up that book, it's easy, it's history, it's all stories. And read maybe every day 10 minutes, 15 minutes, every day. You spend 10 hours on these games and the internet, spend 15, and the book is available online. It's available online. Go look it up. What harm does it do? 15 minutes every day, after maybe a month, you finish the whole book. Okay, now I'm not saying every 5 days or 7 days. In 1 month. Every month. So in a year, you finish 12 books. Is that something that is not feasible, not reasonable? Why don't we all pick up the books of laws, fatawa, and read a little bit? This way we know what is halal, what is haram, how to do wudu, how to do ghusl. I was at a place with a bunch of youth who did not know that they could not do wudu with nail polish. They had nail polish on and they would do wudu on top of that. This makes their wudu batil. Their salat is batil. Okay. They did not know this. So you spend all this time on these websites. Pick up the book, see what invalidates the wudu. What invalidates the salat. Some people think that clean is tahir, when clean is not tahir. A drop of blood, for example, drops here. Someone picks up this Kleenex and goes like this. Khalas, alhamdulillah, it's done. You know, we'll use it now. There's no blood, by the way, you know, just. It's done. This has become clean. Is it tahir? It's not tahir yet, it's still najis. You need to pick up the water. Now I'm not gonna demonstrate this because this will get me wet. And pour it on top of it after you remove the najasa here just one time. And that will clean the blood. If it's urine, you have to do it twice after removing the najasa. Do we know this, ahkam? Many people, unfortunately, don't. They think clean is tahir. No. Someone saw me the other day. He says, I work as a mechanic. And as a mechanic, you know, I have lots of oil and everything. How can I pray? I told him, no problem. Can you do wudu before you get into all this oil? He says, yes, I can do that. I said, okay, then do your wudu. Get your hands dirty, no problem. At the time of salah, go pray. He says, but my clothes are all dirty and everything. I said, dirty is okay. It's tahir. It's dirty, but it's not najis. Many people don't understand this. So the Shia, they are scholars. They have fiqh, faqih. Okay, that's another thing. Number four. We have the W for what? Wise. I for intelligent understanding. S for scholars. The E. And the E, my dear brothers and my dear sisters, as we are going to see here, is effective, control of situations, which Halim, they say Halim. What is Halim? Sometimes they translate as forbearant, someone who's forbearant. What does forbearant really mean? A Halim, when someone comes to shout at him, yell at him, he doesn't immediately get angry and shouts back and punches back. This is not the akhlaq of the Halim. A Halim thinks, assesses the situation, and responds accordingly. You've heard of Bahlul. Bahlul was a companion of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He was a companion. He was a alim, faqih, scholar. Harun wanted him to be a judge in his court. Bahlul did not want that. Tyranny, oppression. What kind of justice system is this? He didn't. He insisted upon him. He went and consulted the Imam salamullah alayhi. Said, Ya ibn Rasulillah, I have no way out. What should I do? He wants me to become a judge. I don't want to be a judge. Every ruling I have to make is against Sharia. He's tyrant. Imam told him, pretend that you have gone crazy. Now, how many, this is not something easy. Imagine you go to a professor at the university who is knowledgeable, you know, he's got students and everything, and you tell him, pretend that you're crazy. How many, us, how many of us would like to pretend to be crazy? And people would point at you on the fingers and say, crazy, crazy, you know. But this was a alim. And he assessed the situation. He listened to the imam. He saw this is the best thing for him to get out of this. The next day, he picks up a stick, like these sticks over there. He picks up a stick, and he goes, horsey, 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 horsey. You know. People came to Harun, and they said, Ya Harun, you know, this Bahlul, you want him to make a judge? He's gone crazy. So what do you mean he's gone crazy? He says, this is what he's doing on the streets. He says, Wallah, he has not gone crazy. But he figured out a way to get out of it. He said, but I will not let him. I will force him. Harun knew what was going on. People told him, Harun, maybe you're right. But how could you have such a man as a judge, for God's sake? What will people say? You know, they say, Harun appointed this man as a judge. He's picking up stick and calling horsey, horsey. So Harun said, you know what, you're right, okay. He tells Bahlul, Bahlul, you managed to get out of it. You managed to get out of it. This is a Halim. Halim. He knows how to use, assess the situation, reacts accordingly. Many times our imams, alayhim wassalam, not one imam, not two imams, maybe all of them, a man would come to them and insult them, or a woman would come to them and insult them. But they are quiet. And they respond with comfort, with ease. Why? Because they realize, they assess the situation. It's not worth to get angry. But rather, if I am calm and quiet, I can guide him. And that indeed works. It works. A man comes to Imam al-Sajjad, alayhi salam, when he's in chain at the gates of Sham. He tells him, Alhamdulillah, Allah killed you, destroyed you, killed your father, killed your uncles. Imam is in chains, bleeding. His women and his children are in front of him in such a state. Imam could have told him, get out. What do you know? But God forbid, the Imam would never say something like this. He told him, Sheikh, I think you don't know. I don't think you have an understanding of what's going on. Did you read the Quran? He told him, Sheikh, that's what he actually said. He said, Sheikh, did you read the Quran? What a beautiful way. He said, yes. But what do you have to do with the Quran? You guys are not even Muslims. He said, Sheikh, ayatul tathir, ayatul mawadda, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَى الْمَوَدَّةِ إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ. These are us. Ahlul. The man said, you really? Serious? He said, yes, wallah. I swear by my grandfather, Rasulullah. The man started beating himself, kissing the arms and the hands of Imam al-Sajjad, kissing his feet. I apologize. I did not know this. That's Halim. That's Hilm. And then the man was killed. Now you tell me, what would have been better? Imam telling him, get away, and the man would have died as an enemy and would have gone to Jahannam, or this. Now he's become a follower and he's gone to Jannah. Which is better? This is something we need to learn and apply, brothers and sisters. And that takes me to the next point. So the E, the effective assessment or reaction to situations. Okay, effective control. That then completes the wise part. What about the Shia part? The S. The S, my dear brothers and my dear sisters, you can put it on right there. Strongly mindful of people, mudaratu nas. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam says, I command you to be respectful to the oppressors, zalimin. If someone says something to you, be kind to them. Be kind to them. Why? Because maybe you can guide them. Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi comes to Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. He says, I apologize. I'm sorry. I'm doing tawbah. Okay. Most of us, let's be frank, what we would have told Hur? Most of us, what we would have said? Now? Now you're doing tawbah? After all you've done? My children are dying from thirst. I am all alone here. No helpers, no supporters. And now you're coming for tawbah? Go to Jahannam. Right? Most of us would have said that. And the Imam, salamullah alayhi, could have said that. Could have said that to him. But then he would have closed the gate of rahmah. And the Imams are rahmatun lil alameen. Imam, salamullah alayhi, tells him, if you are genuine and sincere, I forgive you and Allah forgives you. And so what happens with Hur? He comes, bakhin, bakhin laka ya Hur. Congratulations, Hur. When someone says something to us, is this the way we react? As a community, is this how we deal with one another in the community? Or do we slander one another in the community? Or do we take the ghiba, backbiting one another in the community? How do we deal with one another? Let's be frank. Imam Salam Allah says, one of the attributes of the Shia that we like is a person who accommodates people, mindful of people. He's mindful. He wants to guide them. This Bahlul, no. He even tries to guide Harun, the oppressive tyrant. He tries with him. One day it is said Bahlul managed to sneak into the palace of Harun. He managed to sneak into the palace. He went, he saw the throne empty. He went and sat on the throne. Few seconds later, the guards, the servants, they saw him. Hey, Bahlul, what are you doing? Where are you sitting? They came and they started beating him. And they took him and they threw him out of the palace. So he sat at the door of the palace. Sat at the door, crying. A little while later, Harun came. He sees Bahlul crying. He says, Bahlul, what is the matter? The guards reply. The guards say, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. No, they call him Amir al-Mu'mineen. No. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. This man sat on your throne. So we beat him. We threw him out. Harun, you know, he said, why did you do this? You know who he is. Why did you have to beat him? You could have been gentler with him. So he comes to Bahlul. He says, Bahlul, I'm sorry. You know, they should not have behaved this way. So don't be sad. Don't cry, please. Bahlul looks at him. He says, Harun, I'm not crying for myself. I'm crying for you. Crying for me? Why? He says, I sat on your throne for a few seconds, and they beat me so much. You've been sitting on this throne for how many years? Allah knows what kind of beating you'll get after you die, my friend. You know, only Allah knows what's waiting for you. Few seconds and I got this much. What's going to happen to you? Now, why would he say something like this? Now, he used it as a joke. But what he tries to wake the conscience of Harun. Maybe it will work. And sometimes it does. His conscience does kick in. But subhanAllah, you know, his love for authority turns him back to blindness. So Ahlul Bayt, even with such people, they try to wake them up. And their followers, their Shia, try to take care of them. So he tries to accommodate Harun. Maybe he can guide him. In some cases it worked, like Hur. In some cases it doesn't, like Harun. But we try. That's the S for Shia. The H, thank you, someone is awake with me, that's good. The H is for highly patient. And the word Imam uses is sabur. Sabur is not like sabr. Sabr is someone who's patient. Sabur is someone who's extremely patient. Highly patient. As a Shia, you have to have a lot of patience. Lots. Highly patient. What else? That takes us to the I now. And the I is for ingenuous. What is ingenuous? It means that you are truthful, noble in your communication, in your interaction. And that takes us to the last one, the A, which is adhering to loyalty. Wafi. Wafi. Loyal. Loyal. A Shia is loyal. Loyal to his Imam, loyal to his Prophet, loyal to the Quran, loyal to Islam, loyal to the Mu'mineen. He takes care of them, looks after them to the best of his ability. Mufaddal ibn Amr. Mufaddal ibn Amr, one of the companions of Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. One day he says, I was walking, I saw two Shia arguing. I came to them, I said, what is the problem? Why do you guys argue? What's the matter? He said, you know what? I gave him some money, and he's saying no. And instead of me, he said, I gave him 800, for example. He says, no, I only gave him 500. He wants to take 300 from me. He said, so this whole argument is over 300? He said, yes. He said, come with me home, both of you. He takes them home. He gives them money. He tells the other man, 300? Here's your 300. Take it. Khalas. He looked at him and said, why are you doing this? Why are you paying us? Out of your own pocket. He said, this is not out of my pocket. This is from Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He gave me this money. He told me, whenever you see a disagreement between our Shia, if the disagreement can be solved through money, then use money. Use it. Don't let the Shia be in disagreements. Shia should be loyal to one another, respectful of one another. That's how we should be, brothers and sisters, as a community. That's how we prosper as a community. This is the wise Shia. Inshallah, you remember the W, the I, and the S, the E, and the S, the H, the I, and the A. The wise Shia. And Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, through his kindness, through his loyalty, love, compassion to his followers, guided so many people. But unfortunately, the enemy of Allah, Al-Mansur al-Abbasi, Mansur, wrote to his governor in Medina, Muhammad ibn Sulaiman. He said, finish him. Get rid of him. And indeed, they poisoned the Imam, salamullahi alayhi. The Imam was poisoned. And on a day like this day, the 25th day of Shawwal, Hamida, the wife of the Imam, the mother of Imam al-Kazim, salamullahi alayhi, she says, Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, on his final day, was on his deathbed. He would go into sleep, then wake up from the pain of the poison. Then he turned to me and said, Hamida, call all my family, all my children. Hamida said, I called the whole family. They all gathered together around him. He turned towards them and said, my family, tell our Shia up to the last minute. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam is thinking about his Shia. My dear brothers and my dear sisters, we also have to think about our Imam salamullahi alayhi all the time, following his teachings, especially looking at his grave in this day and age, how dark it is. People cannot even go for his ziyara freely. On his last time, on his last words, he said to Hamida, he turned to all his children, tell our Shia that our shafa'ah, intercession, will not reach the one who takes his salat lightly. In other words, O Shia, when the time of salat comes, we have to pray on time. We have to concentrate in our salat. We have to take it seriously. Because Allah says, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. And the Imam says, our shafa'ah will not reach the one who takes his salat lightly.
Then she said, he stretched his arms and his legs and said, Bismillah wa billah wa ala millati jaddi Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And his soul departed his body. I say, As-salamu alayka ya Mawla, ya Ja'far ibn Muhammad.
And then Imam al-Kadhim alayhi salam took care of the burial of his father, buried him next to his father al-Baqir and his grandfather Zainul Abidin and the uncle al-Hasan salamullahi alayhim ajma'in. I say, Imam al-Kadhim, you were there. Bani Hashim were all around Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam when he left this dunya. But who was there for the ghareeb of Karbala? All alone there, except Zainab salamullah alayha, coming to the body of Abi Abdullah al-Husayn and crying, Aywa Jadda wa Muhammada wa Aliya, Aywa Husayna. Oh, my grandfather, look at Hussein, a body without a head, a body that is gone under the horses of Bani Umayyah, a head that's gone on the spears of Bani Umayyah. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ayyamun qalbin yanqalibun. Raise your hands in dua. This is the time, inshallah, dua is accepted. We are all, inshallah, we are known as the Ja'faris in reference to the Imam, salamullahi alayhi. Inshallah, the Imam will accept our dua. Through his barakat, the dua will be accepted, inshallah. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Amma yujibu al-muttar idha da'a wa yakshifu al-su'. Amma yujibu al-muttar idha da'a wa yakshifu al-su'. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله 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 يا الله. إلهي بفاطمة وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها اكشف عنا السوء يا الله. اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا كفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار يا الله. اللهم اجعلنا وذريتنا إلى يوم الدين من شيعة الإمام الصادق المتقين يا الله ومن خدمة الحسين المخلصين يا الله. اللهم ارزقنا زيارة الإمام الصادق في الدنيا عاجلا يا الله وشفاعته في الدنيا وفي القبر وفي الآخرة يا الله. اللهم اقض حوائج المؤمنين والمؤمنات شافي وعافي جميع مرضى المؤمنين والمؤمنات. انصر شيعة أمير المؤمنين واحفظهم بحفظك ورحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. رب اغفر لي ولوالدي وارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا. اجزهما بالإحسان إحسانا وبالسيئات غفرانا. رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء. اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج واجعلنا من شيعته وأنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل
وليا هو قائدا هو دليلا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوى وتمتعه فيها برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أرنا الطلعة الرشيدة والغرة الحميدة واكحل أنظارنا بنظرة منا إليه. اللهم نقسم عليك بالزهراء فاطمة إلا ما رزقتنا شفاعة الزهراء يا الله يا الله يا الله لقضاء الحوائج ولشفاء المرضى ولكشف هذه الغم عن هذه الأمة ولتعجيل فرج مولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات لا سيما أرواح أموات الجالسين والحاضرين and especially for the روح of our master الإمام الصادق عليه السلام رحم الله من يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات. الله صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجه. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله.